You're not audio. You're not going audio with me. Well, we're sitting, yeah, because we are sitting here. I see you. Yeah. Is that irritating? Okay, so we're ready to go. We'll give it up just a minute or two more since we missed Thursday. So I should unmute, is what you're saying, Sean. I was talking, I was having a great conversation. You heard it. It was really good. So we're pretty much done here now. It's a good class. Now, okay, so let me back up. We do have time to get through the stuff today. So class 10, we've got 11, 12, and 13 left. So we are down the home stretch. I think the most difficult stuff is behind us. And now we get to kind of bring everything together. So we did finish Domain 4 last Tuesday. I apologize for last Thursday not being able to make it. I apologize for the last minute kind of cancellation. But we covered, if you remember Tuesday, we covered Domain 4 and we got into part of Domain 5. So just to recap, we talked about network scanning tools, secure communications, wireless local area networks, and or WLANs. And remote access. So we did finish Domain 4. We got into part of Domain 5. I left off sort of right before Kerberos. Today what we're going to do is we're going to get through all the rest of Domain 5. We're going to get through Domain 6. That's a pretty fast domain, the security testing. And then we'll get partially into Domain 6 tonight. So it's going to be a lot of stuff, but I don't think too much. We'll get through it. These are the other things that we covered last Tuesday, some cornerstone access control concepts. We talked about the access control models. Those were mandatory access control, discretionary access control, and non-discretionary access control. We talked about role-based access control. We talked about context and content-based access control, a bunch of different access control models. We talked about the authentication method. So type one was something you know. Type two is something you have. Type three is something you are. We talked about those things. We talked about false acceptance rate, false reject rate, and crossover error rate. And those are all going to be important things for the exam. We just got started into single sign-on. So that's what we talked about last Tuesday. Today, we're going to pick up from there, but we're going to start with the Domain 4 quiz, which I think you sent out. Yeah. Which is in the back of the book. It's in the book, too. So let's get on it. If anybody wants to answer, feels bold enough. You know, this is all pretty basic, but if you want to type in the chat, the answers, that's fine with me. Well, what just happened? It's back. Did you do that? You hacking? Oh, I have a chat. Yeah, I have it on mine. All right, so which protocol? We already got D's, so I'm guessing D's probably the answer. Which protocol should be used for an audio streaming server where some loss is acceptable? UDP is the right answer because that's a connectionless protocol where we expect the application maybe to compensate for lost packets. TCP was UDP's brother or sister, depending on how you look at it. TCP is a connection-oriented protocol. That was the three-way handshake, the SYN, SYNAC, and ACK-BACK. ICMP and IP both lay on the network layer. ICMP is kind of the traffic cop for IP. IP is responsible for getting packets from one place to another, routing and all those good things. You have receipts? Are you getting reimbursed? Nice. We should share in that. Oh, wait. We do. All right, so D, yes, right answer. What network topology uses fixed length cells, 53 byte, to carry data? ARCNET, ATM, Ethernet, and FIDI. The right answer here is ATM, asynchronous transfer mode. So far we're 2 for 2. Sean and Eric are keeping up. Secure shell servers listen on what port and protocol? TCP port 22. This is a memorization thing. So TCP port 23 is telnet. 20 and 21 are both for FTP. One's for data, one's for control. Good stuff. What network cable type can transmit the most data at the longest distance? Coax, fiber optic, shielded twisted pair, unshielded twisted pair. Fiber optic is the correct answer. Which device operates at layer 2 of the OSI model? Hubs operate at layer 1. Firewalls operate, depending on the type of firewall, but certainly layer 3, 4, 5, and up. Switches operate at layer 2, and routers operate on layer 3. So the answer is C. I'm 5 for 5 right now. Mm-hmm. What are the names of the OSI layers in order from bottom to top? Well, physical and data link are the first two. So that rules out B. Network is the next. Transport is the next. Session, presentation, application. So C is the right answer here. More memorization for people who haven't been through this before. Which of the following authentication protocols uses a three-way handshake, authentication handshake, challenge handshake authentication protocol, extensible authentication protocol, Kerberos, and password authentication protocol? Apple pie shots taste nasty during puking. That's right. That's probably true. Have you tried that? Me neither. The answer here is A. Extensible authentication protocol can use a bunch of different methods for authentication. Kerberos we'll talk about tonight. Password authentication protocol, just passes the password in clear text. That's the non-secure method, and CHEP is the right answer. Restricting Bluetooth device discovery relies on the secrecy of what? MAC address, symmetric key, private key, public key. Have you ever connected a Bluetooth device to another Bluetooth device? You'll know there's two things that are usually required. One is just a, I can't remember the name of it, but the answer here is a MAC address. That's not the right answer. B is not the right answer. A is the right answer. Which wireless security protocol is also known as 802.11i? The full implementation of 802.11i is WPA2. WPA was kind of a, that's your mouse. Is my mouse go over there? We have dueling mices. Yeah, where's yours? No, mine's there. All right, right answer is WPA2. AES is advanced encryption. Look at mine. Mine's right here.
Oh, look at that.
All right. I get immediately, what do they call it? Amused? Yeah. AES, advanced encryption standard, that is typically used by WPA2 to do the authentication. WEP is an old standard that's no longer supported, and then WPA was kind of the stopgap between WEP and WPA2. But the full implementation of WPA2 is the right answer. What is the difference between a stateful firewall and a proxy firewall? Stateful firewalls have state, proxy firewalls do not. That's incorrect. Proxy firewalls have state, stateful firewalls do not. That's incorrect. Stateful firewalls terminate connections. Proxy firewalls do not. That's incorrect. Proxy firewalls terminate connections. Stateful firewalls do not. That's correct. D. Eleven. Which transmission mode is supported by both HDLC and SDLC? Well, SDLC only supports one transmission mode, and that's normal response mode. So that's NRM, so that's got to be the answer. So I'm going with that. And HDLC supports three transmission modes. NRM... I can't remember, ARM and NBM maybe. No, whatever. But I know that SDLC only supports NRM. What is the most secure type of EAP, Extensible Authentication Protocol? EAP TLS, EAP TLLS, LEAP, and PEEP? Right answer here. There's only one here that does client and server authentication because of the PKI implementation. That's EAPTLS. That's what makes it the most secure one here, although it is also the most complex. So maybe you could argue it's not the most secure. What WAN protocol has no error recovery, relying on higher level protocols to provide reliability? X.25 has a ton of error correction in it. The right answer here is B. Frame relay has no error recovery built into the protocol. What's the most secure type of firewall? I guess it kind of depends on who's running it. Huh? Yeah. Packet filter, stateful firewall, circuit level proxy, application level layer proxy. Eric's got a application layer. He's got the most secure type. That's correct, because that operates all the way through all seven layers. The OSI model circuit level proxies operate up to 4.5. Stateful firewalls, typically 3.4, and then packet filter, typically also 3.4. That's kind of what makes it the most secure, is because it application layer proxies can see into the actual data stream and make decisions on that. Accessing an IP version 6 network via an IP version 4 network is called what? CIDR, that's class of center domain routing, RFC 1812, maybe. That's not it. Network address translation, that's not it. Translation or tunneling? Tunneling is the right answer. D. Sean, did you say something to me privately? No, maybe not. All right, good. Looks like 15 out of 15 today. Pat myself on the back. The answers are in the book, too. I didn't actually know any of those. single sign-on. Okay, so this is where we left off last Tuesday. So I'm kind of going over the last couple of slides before we jump into kind of the new stuff. We talked about single sign-on, so you know I may have multiple systems with different authentication databases. A single sign-on solution allows me to log in once, and then that one login can be distributed across you know all or multiple systems. So me as a user, I only have to remember one username and password. That does increase my user productivity, improve developer productivity. I may not even have to build in an application or an authentication database if I can write to the API for the single sign-on solution. And simplified administration. I have one place, one centralized place where maybe I can add and remove and manage user accounts. Those are all good benefits to a single sign-on solution. Some of the disadvantages, difficult to retrofit. Certainly some of the legacy applications may not work well with a single sign-on solution. So, a lot of effort, maybe making it a little clunky. Unattended desktop, if you know somebody leaves their desktop, which never ever happens. Oh, I got a story. Did I ever share the story about a big bank that I worked at? U.S. Bank. Not with this class? Okay. We did an audit once of unattended workstations. This is in the security team. And what we were instructed to do was to put sticky notes that had a meeting invite on them on all of the computers that we saw that had that were unattended and still logged in, not locked. And so that's what we did. And then we came to find out later that day that the meeting that they were invited to, that everybody got fired. And we did that same audit, probably 5 months later. And there wasn't a single system that we found that wasn't locked or wasn't locked and unattended. So I guess the point is, you know, when we're always kind of going to be frustrated with people locking their workstations, and a lot of times we'll put a 5 minute or 10 minute or 15 minute lockout, inactivity lockout on the workstation, but we still have users who don't log out. And so there's a time window. And, you know, one of the risks is, you know, if you leave your workstation unattended and unlocked, then, you know, people can access all the stuff that you can as you, that compounds. The problem get compounded with a single sign-on solution. And then the last single point of attack. So one authentication database potentially that we could attack to get credentials that allows us to go throughout the environment. So really protect it. All right, so some new stuff. Access provisioning lifecycle. This is always a challenge, it seems, with you know many organizations is you know, all the way from provisioning to deprovisioning user accounts. So provisioning, setting up the account, assigning the right permissions, and all those things. Having access requests being approved by the correct personnel, which usually we would want that to be a system or an application owner as opposed to just a manager or IT sometimes gets stuck with, you know, approving access requests, assigning the access. And then once we have access, as roles change throughout the organization, you know, handling the modification of user accounts, or really the best way to do it, if you wanted to be the most secure, would be to deprovision an old user account and reprovision an account in the new role. Disabling, retiring, reconciling, all those things are important in an access provisioning lifecycle. And the point here is that there's a lot more to managing user accounts, managing privileges than just creating a user account and putting it in into a group. And this is a pretty common area of improvement that we find in organizations. So good stuff. IBM describes the following identity lifecycle rules: password policy compliance checking, notifying users to change their passwords before they expire. We've all seen that. Identifying lifecycle changes such as accounts that are inactive for more than 30 consecutive days. There are scripts that you can run to do this. One of the tools that we use when we do assessments and audits is a tool called Network Detective, made by Rapid Fire Tools. It's just an easy, inexpensive tool that we use with a lot of customers. And one of those things that it will provide for us will be a spreadsheet of all the user accounts that haven't logged in the last 30 days. Those are important things to to reconcile. You know, potentially they're gone and we missed it in the deprovisioning of the user account. Identify new accounts that have not been used for more than 10 days following their creation. This is an indication that potentially a user account was created and the person never actually started or never showed up for their first day of work. And that's usually, not usually, but you know, that could be a potential gap in the access provisioning lifecycle. Identifying accounts that are candidates for deletion because they have been suspended for more than 30 days. So in Active Directory, it would be disabling the account. Once that account's been disabled for X number of days, then maybe it should be marked for deletion and removal. It's not uncommon to find in a company of, you know, just a couple hundred employees to do a user account audit and find, you know, 5,000-6,000 user accounts that are still in Active Directory. Most of them are disabled, but there's really been no cleanup to it. When a contract expires, identifying all accounts belonging to a business partner or contractor employees and revoking their access rights. So third-party vendor access. These are all good identity lifecycle rules. And you can probably think of a few more that you could add to it. It just becomes part of your process. So authorization creep is something that I think we've talked about it before. But usually it happens when a user changes roles within an organization and they still retain the role, the permissions or privileges that they had in the previous role. That's authorization creep. And again, one way to do that is to deprovision the user account and then recreate a user account as they move to a new place in the organization. That's one way to be sure that there's no authorization creep. Either disable and then eventually delete the account and then recreate one, or remove all the permissions from the user account and reassign them. User rights and entitlements must be routinely reviewed. A good best practice for reviewing user accounts, it really depends on how much change there is in the environment, whether there's a lot of role changes that happen or there's high turnover. Those would both indicate that we should do user account reviews more frequently. But you know, a good best practice would be probably semi-annual or more often. For the exam, the advice like that, it just comes from me. It's stuff like, you know, every 6 months, a best practice that wouldn't be on the exam. But understanding what these are and the importance of it should be. Other things for single sign-on, identity as a service. Did you do that again? What are you doing, man? I'm trying to teach over here. I don't want it. I'm just trying to make it easier for you. If I didn't have you to give grief to, I'd be so bored just sitting here. So now they get, yeah, a little boringer. Yeah, most boreder. All right, so identity as a service. Gartner describes two categories for identity as a service: web access software and cloud-based applications, such as software as a service, web architected applications and cloud delivered legacy identity management services. Azure would be an example of an identity as a service, where, you know, essentially I can take my Active Directory and my authentication databases and plop them in the cloud. LDAP, Lightweight Directory Access Protocol. This is really just a protocol over a network. So in this case, it's two network systems or multiple network systems querying and sort of sharing authentication or directory service information. Standard ports for LDAP, TCP, UDP, port 389, that's clear text, and then LDAP over TLS, TCP 636 and 3269, for those of you who are segmenting and firewalling your network. That doesn't happen very often, though. All right, so Kerberos. This is so Kerberos. I'm going to go through a bunch of kind of facts about Kerberos, and then I'll just show, you know, briefly how it works. Kerberos is definitely going to be very testable. It's very used. It's in Microsoft. It's built into, or at least a version of it is built into, Microsoft operating systems. A third-party authentication service used to support single sign-on, Kerberos. I don't know if you're a mythology person, but the three-headed dog that guarded Hades. Is Hades like hell? Or is Hades like the dead people place? Three heads of mythical Kerberos were meant to signify, is that you again? Oh, look, people are typing. Bad dead place. Hades is hellish. Elysium is good. You have Hades' wife on yours? Oh, you're curious about Hades. All right. So we do have some Greek mythology folk here. That's cool. God of the underworld. Sounds like a place not to be. So three A's, authentication, authorization, and accountability. That's so that triple-headed dog is meant to represent, you know, those three A's. Original Kerberos mainly provided authentication. It was developed by, I didn't put it here anywhere, did I? MIT is where it was originally developed. Some frequently asked questions. So if you want to know more about Kerberos and dig in more, there's a ton of information. It is open source, so you can, you know, read all kinds of stuff about Kerberos. It's a network authentication system for physically insecure networks. So this is assuming that that I can't assure the medium, the transport medium between two systems. This is a great place to use Kerberos. And so in larger organizations, or in organizations where I don't have good cabling security, or just organizations in general, Kerberos would work well for authentication. Based on the key distribution model presented by Needham and Schroeder, allows entities communicating over networks to prove their identity to each other. This is two-way authentication. There's authentication of the server and authentication of the client in Kerberos. While preventing eavesdropping or relay attacks, all the data is encrypted. Provides a data stream integrity modification, detection of modification and secrecy, preventing unauthorized reading, so on and so forth, using DES. That's the original Kerberos implementation, uses DES, which we all know has been replaced by either triple DES or AES. Uses secret key encryption. So keys have to be set up on both sides, and keys will be used for hashing tickets to prove identity and provide that integrity. Provides mutual authentication of both clients and servers, protects against network sniffing and replay attacks. Current version is version 5 in RFC 4120. If you remember RFCs, those are requests for comments. Those are governing documents for the internet. So it's an open, approved standard. The following components. So the principal is referred to, the client or service, it would be referred to as the principal. The realm, so in a Microsoft world, that'd be a domain. It's a logical Kerberos network. A ticket, it's the data that authenticates a principal's identity, credentials, a ticket and service key. So a lot of this stuff is going to be just memorization at this point. The KDC, or the Key Distribution Center, which authenticates the principals, TGS, TGT, and CS. Those are all functional components. And this shows you just a little bit of how that works. So here we've got Sam, needs a ticket to get tickets. So TGT sends that request to the Key Distribution Center, which really is part of two things. You've got an authentication service and the ticket granting service. For the purpose of the test, those would be two separate systems, but they can be combined into one system. The response back is, here's your TGT. If you can decrypt this resource with your password hash. So it's been encrypted, sort of, with the secret key, more hashed with it. Here's the TGT, give me a service ticket, and then the response back, here's your service ticket, and then the service ticket is taken to whatever services or systems that I need to authenticate to on the network, and then there's a client-server session set up. So that's a pretty basic how Kerberos works. And I think that's sufficient for the exam. But if you do want to know more about Kerberos, if you're curious, there's tons of resources to refer to. So some of the strengths of Kerberos: mutual authentication client server, that's a good thing. KDCs can be spoofed, so you could insert a rogue KDC to be the real KDC, but I wouldn't have that secret key or the other keys for hashing. But another bad thing, and I didn't even put it in here, mitigates replay attacks. Keys are stored in clear text for Kerberos. That's probably the biggest weakness. Oh, strength. I'm on strengths. Weaknesses. Okay, I confused myself. So mutual authentication client server, that's good. Rogue KDC, but I wouldn't have the keys. So if I did have the keys, which I can get them because, potentially, because the keys are stored in clear text on both the client and the server. But I wouldn't be able to just insert a KDC into this mix without having the keys. Mitigates replay attacks because if you sniff it, you're just going to see encrypted mumbo jumbo. You'll see ciphertext. And then it also uses timestamps. Some of the weaknesses for KDC is the KDC does store plain text keys of all the principals for clients and servers. So a compromise of the KDC can lead to a compromise of really everything in the Kerberos realm or the domain. KDC and TGS are single points of failure. Replay attacks are still possible for the lifetime of the authenticator. So there's timestamps applied to all the tickets that are, that's you. You got a calculator now. That's pretty cool, man. All right. So replay attacks are actually possible. Usually, I can't remember. Usually, I think 10 hours. Seems like the default for Kerberos for the lifetime. Could also launch denial service attack. Any user can request a session key for another user, and Kerberos does not mitigate a malicious local host. So if something has been compromised and we've accessed or captured plain text keys in memory or cache, then we could use that to authenticate too. The biggest point for Kerberos, probably the number one most referenced weakness for Kerberos, is the plain text keys in the KDC. If a person has been authenticated but their account is subsequently disabled, can they continue to access until that ticket expires? Yes. Yep, in most cases. Well, in the standard deployment of Kerberos, that's not true in current implementations. So a replacement for Kerberos, meant to really go at Kerberos, its biggest weakness would be Sesame, secure European system for applications in multi-vendor environment. Single sign-on supports heterogeneous environments, can be thought of as a SQL sorts to Kerberos. All those things are true. Uses privileged access certificates in place of tickets. And if you want to know more information about Sesame, that's there. The biggest thing about Sesame is, one, it's European, it's a single sign-on solution, and it doesn't store keys in plain text. Radius. Radius has been around forever. There's so many different flavors and versions of Radius and commercial Radius, but at the core of Radius, it is an open system. Two RFCs, 2865 and 2866, stands for Remote Dial-In User Service Protocol, third party. Uses UDP 1812 and 1813, one's for authentication, the other's for accounting. Used to use ports 1645 and 1646, both also UDP, same purposes. Also considered an AAA system. So authenticates, authorizes, and has an accounting function. The authentication and authorization happen over port 1812. The accounting function happens over 1813. And when you think of accounts, think of logs, log entries, and the like. A little more about Radius. Uses attribute value pairs. So if you're AVPs, you're talking Radius. Some of the codes, access request. So you can kind of play through this, and I'm going to show you a diagram real quick, but you kind of play through how this would work in your mind. So an access request, an access accept message back, or an access reject, an accounting request, accounting response, access challenge. Those are the codes. Status server and status client are both experimental. This is just a typical simple radius diagram where a radius server would sit, potentially a radius proxy. You have access clients, network access servers. So network access servers are actually the client to the radius server and the user account database. Pretty simple. Any questions, Rob? None. All right. Diameter, the successor to Radius. The big thing about Diameter is it has a lot more AVPs and it uses TCP instead of UDP. So Radius's successor improved authentication, authorization, and accounting because it has a bunch more attribute value pairs. There's a lot more things that you can log and use Diameter for. Radius, 8 bits for the AVP, so 2 to the 8th is 256 possible AVPs, whereas Diameter is 32 bits, meaning a lot of potential AVPs. AVPs, again, attribute value pairs. Single server to manage policies for many services provides the same AAA functionality, but expanded. TCP and RFC 3588, another open standard. TACX and TACX Plus. TACX is the older version, not really used much anymore, except for in some legacy things in TACX Plus. They're not compatible, so TACX Plus won't work in a TACX environment. TACX stands for Terminal Access Control or Access Control System. Centralized Access Control, sending user ID and static password for authentication. TACX uses a UDP port 49. Could use TCP if you configured it that way. Reusable passwords certainly have a security vulnerability. TACX Plus also allows two-factor authentication. So one of the big differentiators between TACX and TACX Plus is TACX is also is static passwords. TACX Plus allows a lot more flexibility, including two-factor authentication. You see two big important big differences too in TACX and TACX Plus is TACX uses UDP, TACX Plus uses TCP, same port, 49. Similar to Radius. Radius encrypts only the password, TACX Plus encrypts everything under the TACX header. So more access control protocols and frameworks. I lost my mouse. Did you take my mouse again? And then we went through PAP and CHAP just briefly before, but they come up again here. The password authentication protocol, not secure at all. Username and password are both sent in clear text. So not a strong authentication method. You can tell by the RFC number. That's really, really old if it's 1334. Challenge authentication or handshake authentication protocol, like we mentioned before, the password isn't actually sent in clear text. The password's not actually sent at all. It's the challenge, and then it's the hash and response back and what have you. Defined in RFC 1994, no replay attacks. So sniffer doesn't work either. And then Active Directory, which I'm guessing for people that are technical, Active Directory is probably very, very common to you. I don't know. I can remember the days when it was more Novell. I actually ran into a Novell network last week, which is sort of weird. But Microsoft Active Directory, concepts of domains. So a domain sort of loosely can be compared to as a Kerberos realm. Primary means to control access would be the domain. It's a container, if you will. Novell. I don't even know what version it was. Pretty much failed there. So for authentication purposes, bases the authentication on trust relationships. So you've got transitive and non-transitive trust. You'll need to know that for the exam, but I think I got it on the next slide. On RFC 1510, Kerberos authentication protocol fully integrated in Windows OS since 2000. Each domain has a separate authentication process in space. So a domain is usually under one administrative authority. So don't think one organization only has one Active Directory domain. It may have multiple, but each domain kind of has its own authentication process and its own namespace, and usually its own authoritative group or purpose. Each domain has different users, different network assets, and different data objects. Two-way trust between domains. So it's just like it said, there's one-way trust and two-way trust, transitive and non-transitive. So here are the different types of trust. So one-way trust, I trust Rob, Rob doesn't trust me. So all the data flows one way. And a two-way trust, it's more of a relationship between the two domains where we share resources. I can pull from him, he can pull from me, and vice versa. Trusts, either transitive and non-transitive. A non-transitive trust is, I trust Rob, but I don't trust all the things that Rob trusts. That's a non-transitive trust. A transitive trust would be, I trust Rob, and I also trust everybody that Rob trusts. So those are different types of trust. So you're talking about between the domains, so that we can share authentication data, share objects, you know, things like that. But you will need to know that for the exam. One-way, two-way, trust, transitive, and non-transitive. That's it. We finished domain five. We still have like an hour and 18 minutes left. So let's move on. Domain six, security assessment and testing. I'm kind of a assessment and testing kind of guy, so I like this domain quite a bit. Assessing access control, software, testing methods. Here's some unique terms, dynamic testing and static testing. So there are four bullet points difference between these, but they're very closely related. Dynamic testing is essentially testing the application while it's running, whereas static testing is testing the application while it's not running. Oftentimes it's using, you know, source code and looking at that. Fuzzing is essentially sending a bunch of crazy data at a system to see if you can make it crash or see if you can make it act the way it's not supposed to act. In the purest form, fuzzing is supposed to make the system crash, and that gives you an indication potentially that you've got a buffer overflow or some kind of an input validation problem. Fuzzing we'll talk about a little bit more too. Penetration testing, that's probably one of the most overused, most misunderstood terms in all of security, maybe that or risk. But penetration testing, the important thing about penetration testing that makes it different than vulnerability scanning is penetration testing actually has some exploitation to it. So it takes it to the next level. There's a bunch of different types of penetration testing. But at this base level, penetration testing means that there's an attempted exploitation. So the definition here, authorized attempt to break into an organization's physical or electronic perimeter, or sometimes both. Penetration testing, in the traditional sense, people think is like hackers trying to hack into a computer system. Physical penetration testing is, I think, more fun, but that's also a type of testing. And then synthetic transactions, which seems kind of buzzwordish, but basically it's building scripts, building things to continually simulate activities, maybe normal activities, maybe abnormal activities. Most of the time it's normal activities just to see that the system still responds the way it's supposed to. Anything different might indicate that there's an error or a problem. And Rob, you need to stop doing that right now. All right. I guess we'll introduce you to black hats and white hats, and then there's the gray hats too. So black hats are bad guys, white hats are good guys, and gray hats are the confused guys. Might as well just be black hat, because I don't think you can really be straddling both sides, but maybe. So black hat attackers, malicious attackers, sometimes called crackers. And you can think of, you know, Darth Vader, wore all black. No ethics, or very few ethics. Violate laws, break into computer systems without gray hats are the guys who didn't separate the law. Yeah, good point. Yep. Accidentally washed gray socks. Or gray hats. I guess if you wash hats. Do you wash it? I don't know. I might have just confused myself. White hat hackers are the good guys. Ethical hackers, sometimes we call them. But these are the people that we employ, you know, at FRSecure. These are the guys that have, you know, really outstanding ethics. You don't even question. They don't cross lines. They don't break rules. They only do what they've been told to do. They follow the letter of engagement. If there's questions, they stop testing and get clarification. So white hats are definitely the good guys. And then gray hats are, I guess it kind of depends. They may not have a malicious intent, but they still break the law or they still compromise ethics. There's a lot of things. They say the goal of a gray hat is to improve system and network security. You still need to, in my opinion, you still need to play by the rules. But that is the one thing that really sets us apart. You know, when you talk about like penetration testing, there are certain things that we won't do in a patient penetration test that a black hat attacker wouldn't even question not doing. So you're always going to have kind of this gap between what an ethical person will do and what an unethical person will do. So even a true white hat test or a true penetration test, you still miss that little gap. So that's just the way it is. So penetration tester is a white hat hacker who receives authorization to attempt to break into an organization's physical or electronic perimeter, or sometimes both. Penetration test, called pen test for short, determine whether black hat hackers could do the same. But there's always going to be that little bit of gap. It's really important that you do receive authorization because failure to do so is, you know, prosecuted. There have been stories in the past of people who thought that, they had good maybe intentions, but they didn't have the authorization and they ended up being prosecuted for things. Penetration test, typically a narrow test. When we say a narrow test, meaning that there are specific objectives that are meant to be met by the penetration testing. There's something specific that we're trying to validate or invalidate during testing. So there really needs to be focus to a penetration test. The alternative is you have a penetration test that never ever finishes because there's always new things to try. There's always additional research that can be done. So if you don't really make the test narrow, you end up never finishing the test. Penetration tests may include the following tests: network internet, network internal or DMZ war dialing, wireless war dialing doesn't really happen anymore as much. I suppose there's still people doing that. Wireless testing, physical, trying to gain entrance to a facility or room in wireless. We have good people in all these areas, except for war dialing. We just don't do that anymore. Some really good stories too. I guess someday we can sit around and have coffee and chat about some of these. I kind of want to go into some of them, but I shouldn't. So network attacks may leverage client-side attacks. So remember when we talked about client-side and server-side attacks? One easy way to get yourself into a network in a penetration test is trick people to download something, a piece of malware. That would be a client-side attack, and then use that plant to then pivot and attack other systems. Server-side attacks is going directly at the server or the service, and then web application attacks are all common types of attacks. And I think they're all pretty self-explanatory. War dialing, the reason why we don't do this much anymore is because there's really just not as many modems out there as there used to be. Modems used to be the only way really to connect back in the day, and so what you do is you just call a block of numbers and look for anything that gave a carrier tone, and you would log that, and then, Rob, are you freaking kidding me? Did you just do that again? These guys are... what are you doing? Give me your credit card. What is it? What can I buy with this? Is this yours? It's a Best Buy card. Do you know I have a photographic memory and I just memorized everything that was on that card? All right. And I'm ethical, so we're good. But if you do that one more time, I don't know. Retribution. All right, no, I'm just kidding. Trying to make it somewhat entertaining. So war dialing, So what you do is it was pretty fun back in the day. You just call it a block of numbers, and then you would log the ones that had carrier tones, and to come back to those ones that had carrier tones, and then try to authenticate. Try with default credentials first. Some of them had no authentication at all. And then war games. Would you like to play a game? Is that what he says? Shall we play a game? Okay. I suck at remembering movie stuff. Matthew Broderick. I've seen it numerous times, but all right, so social engineering uses human minds. Social engineering is one of my favorite things to do. Talking people out of things and this is certainly an area where the black hat, white hat thing comes in. Because black hats will manipulate people, whereas white hat people will influence people. We won't really manipulate. There's a line that gets crossed when I use something very distasteful against you, or like I convince you that your mother has cancer in order to talk you into doing something. That's something a white hat would never do, but a black hat would go there. A lot of fun doing social engineering attacks. There's three types of social engineering attacks we do. One is electronics, so it's phishing, getting people to do things that they shouldn't do that way. Another one is phone, so calling up people and talking them out of things or what have you. Then the third way is typically just a physical, shall we play a game? There we go. Joshua. We gotta do some trivia. Give out gifts or something, or prizes. All right. The third type is physical social engineering attack, trying to get into a location. Lots of different ways to do all this stuff. Different types of penetration testing: zero knowledge, full knowledge, and partial knowledge. Pretty much what they self-explanatory. But zero knowledge is called the black box test. That's where we know nothing. Or very little or nothing about the target before we start an attack. Those are really pretty rare, because what we prefer to do is to have a solid letter of engagement first. So a lot of times we'll do more of a partial knowledge test. So we know some things about the organization, but we don't know everything. We don't have diagrams and source code and whatever else. So zero knowledge, knowing nothing, going in blind, called black box testing. Full knowledge, crystal box, I've never really called it that, but it's what it said in the book. But it's really knowing just about everything. It's an open book. Then partial knowledge is somewhere in between. Yeah, and then that fourth bullet point really is important. You have to have a really well-defined scope and penetration tests to limit the time that you're spending on the test. And also to establish really solid boundaries, because if you're not clear, you could cause some unintended consequences in your testing. Some tools. So these are pretty well-known tools. Metasploit, obviously. We've still got the framework, which is still open source, but there's a commercial version of Metasploit 2 now owned by Rapid7. Closed source, Core Impact. Core Impact is like the bomb. That's the best tool ever for pen testing. It almost makes it too easy, but it's also really expensive, $60,000, $70,000, $80,000 for that tool. Immunity Canvas, I've never used it, but that's another one. Then you can always go to the top 125 network security tools. So if you're interested in pen testing and you like the hacker type of thing, these are just common tools. I mean, most of us know about all of them, but they're good tools to build your own tool repository. You just did it again. Yeah, I saw that. And custom tools, you can make your own too. Penetration testers, essentially it's the same methodology. So you first plan your attack. What are the different ways that we could accomplish what we need to accomplish? You do reconnaissance first. Our definition of reconnaissance is all the things that we can do to learn about the target without actually touching or sending anything at the target. So it's looking through things like Google, my brain is totally escaping me, Shodan, other data repositories looking for information about the target potentially, scanning. So this is usually the first part where you're actually sending traffic at the system. It depends on the different, you know, we talked about the different types of scans before, whether it's a full connect scan or just a SYN scan or, you know, Christmas, whatever kind of scan we're going to use. Nmap would be a great tool to use for enumeration. Then vulnerability assessment. So once we've enumerated the systems, now we need to identify. So in that enumeration, we've determined kind of the services that are listening. The vulnerability assessment is usually means one of two things. We find vulnerabilities. It's either missing at this level, usually missing patches or a bad configuration. So interrogating the services to find out what version you know, the service might be running, and then comparing that with just a known database. We're not talking zero-day stuff here, usually. Usually don't have to go that far. So vulnerability assessment, then you know, finding those ones that are going to be candidates for exploitation and running exploits, and then writing reports. Black hat attackers do follow, I'd say, a similar methodology. But they also cover their tracks. So typically, an attacker gets to the vulnerability assessment. They find the vulnerability and then exploit it. The thing that's not listed here for the next step would be to elevate privileges. So somewhere between exploitation and reporting would be to elevate privileges. Then it'd be to plant a backdoor or pivot. And then you start the whole process again at the scanning piece. And then it'd be delete log files. So I make it a persistent connection by leaving, you know, backdoor and come back later. So there are some things that black hats would do that aren't necessarily in this methodology. Hopefully that makes sense. All right, so things that we need to be careful for when we're doing penetration tests, certainly ensure confidentiality. If you find, and there's a lot of things. So in penetration testing, you know, in the rules of engagement, we would, if the systems that we're going after might contain, you know, protected health information or credit card information, we need to spell out what we do with that if that's encountered during the testing. Another thing is, you know, if you encounter child pornography, do you have to report that to the FBI? So there are things, you know, that we need to be sure that we're accounting for in our penetration test before we actually do one. Testers will often request that a dummy file, so something that doesn't have, we would call this a flag or a target. So put something on the system that you want us to get to prove that we were able to compromise the system to get to it. And then make sure we leave. So oftentimes we'll also leave, or we'll, our testing should be documented in a manner that we can put the systems back to the exact state that we found them, or we do penetration testing on test systems that are completely identical to production systems. But somehow, we need to be able to restore or ensure the integrity of the production systems, whether it means that we have documented enough that we can bring it back to the original state, or we've done a backup or something, or you know, we're testing on a test environment and not production. Yeah. Oh, and the last bullet point was, if you're doing penetration testing, you find that somebody else is there or somebody else has been there, what are you going to do with that, which happens too? All right, so that's pen testing. Now you're all pen test experts. No, we have enough to know basic what it looks like. But now vulnerability testing. So vulnerability testing, if you go back to the pen testing, we've got, you know, in our methodology, the vulnerability assessment, this is sort of that. So this is kind of where I think some of the confusion comes between vulnerability testing or vulnerability scanning and penetration testing, because penetration testing might use vulnerability scanning. The big difference is that we've got that exploitation that comes. I go back here again. We've got the exploitation that comes after the vulnerability assessment. That's what makes it penetration testing. That's kind of the big differentiator. All right, so vulnerability scanning. What we're looking for in vulnerability scanning is vulnerabilities. And like I said before, we typically find vulnerabilities in one of two areas. It's either missing patches or updates. So there's a bug in the software. Because most of your vulnerability scanners, like Nessus, OpenVAS, Qualys, Rapid7, Expose, those are all going to use plugins or signatures of known vulnerabilities. That's how they're configured. So it's probably not going to find zero-day stuff. It's going to find patch, you know, so it's going to find evidence that a patch hasn't been applied or that an update hasn't been applied to the software. The other thing that we would use vulnerability scanning for, where we might find vulnerabilities is configuration errors, usually default configs, SNMP, public-private, find that one all the time, you know, stuff like that. There's also the common vulnerability scoring system, or called CVSS, which is a governmental scoring system. It's on version 3 now. Version 2 is kind of the one that most of the vulnerability scanners are still referencing. But what it does, it gives us the ability to score how critical these vulnerabilities actually are in my environment, which is kind of nice, because if I want to measure one vulnerability scan against another vulnerability scan, or measure vulnerability scans over time, this is a metric that I can use in my my vulnerability scanning to do that. So keywords here, predefined vulnerabilities. So these are vulnerabilities that are already known about. Vulnerability scanners aren't going to find things that nobody knew about before. All right, so that's pen testing, vulnerability testing, now security audits. An audit really is just testing against a published standard, and it's usually to validate or verify. It's checklist to validate or verify that you've met the standard or not. That's sort of an audit. So PCI DSS compliance is certainly one of those standards where you would typically call that an audit. SOC 2 Type 1 and SOC 2 Type 2 are other types of audits that are fairly common. These are more accounting audits. Statement on compliance, I think, is the, I never remember what SOC stands for, but SOC 2 Type 1 and SOC 2, the difference between Type 1 and Type 2, Type 1 is a snapshot in time, Type 2 is more testing over time, 6 months, 12 months, but it's checklist. You know, do you do this or not? If you do it, then you pass. If you don't, then you don't. That's a security audit. Slightly different than an assessment. So an assessment is more holistic in nature. In assessments, the key word here is assessing the effectiveness of an access control. So you may not have the access control in place, or you may not have a control in place. Now we need to assess the effectiveness, or what the impact is of not having that control in place. We usually base that on risk, which is the likelihood and impact, stuff that we talked about really way back in class 1. Typically a very broad scope, multiple domains. You can see, you know, examples, policies, procedures, administrative controls, change management, architectural review, pen tests, all those things can be incorporated into a security assessment. Keywords, assessing the effectiveness, where there are gaps in the control. So a gap in a control could be construed as a weakness or a vulnerability, and then we need to determine what the applicable threats are to that control gap. So at the end of the day, we call it risk. This is really where I'd say 50% of our business, 50% of the stuff that we do here at FRSecure kind of comes in. So we're really pretty mature on this part. And this is just an example of how we would score things according to risk. This comes out of a real report, but we fuzzied stuff. All right, so internal and third-party audits. Internal audits are usually, you know, in large organizations, companies that have, you know, SOCs compliance issues to deal with, or maybe large healthcare, large insurance companies. There's an internal audit function typically in those organizations, sometimes referred to as corporate audit. So the audit is initiated internally. Information security groups should do their own audits as well to determine if we're actually doing the things that we're mandating in policy and that we're thinking that we're doing. really, I break it down, and this isn't in the book either, but usually I break it down into two types of audits. You have structured audits and then unstructured audits. Really different purposes for internal audits. So in a structured audit, let's say that I have to be compliant with the model audit rule, or I have SOX compliance, or I have a SOC 1 or an SSE 16 audit that I need to undergo, which are more financial. But the audience is external. So there's some regulator, there's some external entity who's relying on my validation of specific controls. That's more of a structured audit because it happens over and over and over again. The audience is external, so it's kind of in our best interest to make that audit look as good as it can without breaking the rules. And the purpose is to validate compliance. Whereas the unstructured audits, these are the ones that we might, you know, we're going to do a backup audit, or we're going to do a database security audit, or we're going to, you know, whatever. It's more of an unstructured audit. It's internal audience, and the purpose really is to find stuff. You know, whereas, you know, the structured audits, we don't necessarily want to find things because we don't want to share that. But in the unstructured audits, it's like find whatever you can. But those are kind of internal audit type functions. Third-party audits is where you add, you know, you bring somebody from outside of the organization to conduct an audit. Hopefully they're experts, they're qualified in the audits that they're going to be performing. They add credibility to the audit. So if I'm going to, if I audit myself and I grade myself an A, I say, hey man, look, I graded, you know, I scored an A, that lacks credibility. But if somebody else credits or audits my A and says, yeah, it's really an A, then, you know, it lends credibility to it. And, you know, teaching, there's always teaching opportunities in third-party audits because hopefully they really are the experts and you can learn some things from, you know, how they conduct those things. Security audit logs. Everybody's got them. Nobody knows what they got in them. Audit logs are, so audit logs on all your systems, so it's the third A in the authentication authorization. Hey, how come you left me here? Rob, how come you left me here by myself? Jeez. What? Yeah. So systems log a bunch of information. Now, why logs become really important. Logs can be an indication of something bad happened. So I might initiate an incident response based on log entries. They also give me really good information to conduct an investigation if something actually bad has been confirmed. So logs, common log problems, according to Anton Chuvakin. One, logs are not reviewed on a regular and timely basis. Audit logs and audit trails are not stored for a long enough period of time. So log reviews, you know, like I said, we would use that to identify anomalies or things that look potentially, we would call those events. Usually events become incidents, and then the incident becomes an incident response. So there's a bunch of events that happen kind of in my logs, and looking through those events to try to identify a potential incident. I think, I don't know what the average time is for organizations to identify, to identify a breach, but it's like 18 months or something. I can't remember what the latest stat is. So, I mean, things are going on poorly, or, you know, attacks are going on in the network and nobody knows about it. One of the ways you might be able to find that is if you reviewed the logs. So we reduce that. We can't prevent everything, but the things we can't prevent, we should be able to detect. And once we detect them, we should be able to correct them. If we're not detecting, that's a big gap. Audit logs and audit trails are not stored for a long enough period of time. So from the time that an event happens to the time that I actually detect and initiate some type of an investigation, you know, kind of in the correction world, in that time, if logs have been overwritten, you know, if they're cycling or they've been just deleted for retention purposes, it's going to really hinder the investigation. So I need to keep the logs for a long enough period of time to enable me to detect something bad happened and then respond to it. So it's different in different organizations. It might be 12 months. It might be 6 months. In a PCI world, it's going to have to be 6 months. minimum live in 12 months, I think. I don't know, I'm not really a PCI guy, but you see what I'm saying. You have to keep those logs long enough to, you know, enable a good incident response. Logs are not standardized or viewable by correlation tool sets. So being able to take logs and correlate them with other logs. Log entries and alerts are not prioritized. Audit records are only reviewed for the bad stuff. Because a lot of times what you see in patterns for attacks, and one of the classics is, you know, you see 15 or 50 consecutive invalid login attempts, and then the very next one is a valid login attempt. That's a great indication that something, I think 6 months, is it 6 months live though, and 1 year offline or something? I don't know. But if I'm only looking for the bad stuff, I'll see the 50 invalid login attempts, but I'll miss the valid one. So if the valid one is the indication that the password was actually cracked. So if I'm only looking for the bad stuff and I see 50 invalid login attempts and then they stop, they must have just gave up. So it's important to keep that in mind when you're reviewing log files too, that don't just look for the bad stuff. Those are all common errors. Reviewing security audit logs, certainly in an IT system, is one of the easiest ways. Easiest. It's not the easiest, but it could be the easiest way to verify that things are working the way you intended them to work. Typically very time-consuming unless you're using some type of an SIEM solution. Reviewing audit logs is primarily a detective control, so we're looking for evidence of something bad or something bad could or might soon happen. According to NIST Special Publication 800-92, the following log types should be collected. So this comes into play too is like CISSecurity.org, Center for Internet Security, has some really good benchmarks and tools. And in those benchmarks, you know, you can apply those benchmarks to, you know, say a Windows Server operating system. They have different types of benchmarks, but in those benchmarks are log settings that will enable, you know, a lot of these things or enable some compliance. Now, obviously, you just sort of want to apply that right to a production system, you know, test it first, but that's one place where you can get log information kind of implemented, you know, into your environment. But the types of logs that you should collect, network security software, hardware, antivirus logs, IPS, IDS logs, remote access software, VPN logs, web proxy, vulnerability management, authentication servers, routers and firewalls, and system events, audit records, applications, system requests and server responses, usage information, significant operational actions, lots of logs. So pretty easy, right? You just grab all these logs and just go out to all these systems and, you know, review them every day. Not probably going to happen. So one of the things that we can implement that might help is a centralized logging solution. So centralized logging gives me two, I think, really big pieces. Well, three. Log retention is a big deal because, like I said, I need to retain those logs to enable me to conduct a thorough investigation at some point. Then you've got legal and regulatory compliance. Like Chris stated in our chat, you know, PCI, we have to retain logs for a year, 3 months live. So having that centralized logging solution to get those logs off and protected within your, you know, cardholder data environment that's one way we could do that. The other thing is log protection. So in a typical attack sequence that I mentioned with the black hat attacker, you know, you identify a vulnerability, compromise the vulnerability, elevate your privileges, plant the backdoor, delete log files. Now, if I've got the log file stored in a centralized logging system, the attacker may not even notice I'm doing that, but if that centralized logging system has different authentication, so you compromised and elevated the privileges on the target server, but you don't have the credentials to the centralized logging system, you know, that also gives me, you know, some added protection. So that centralized logging piece is actually kind of a big deal. So SIEM, I don't think it's probably going to be in the exam. I don't recall seeing it in the book, but that's security information and event management. Some people call it security incident and event management. I prefer security information and event management. But the four big things that an SIEM solution does beyond just centralized logging: log protection, aggregation, so taking log files from various systems and aggregating them together in one central location. It also does correlation, so being able to correlate logs from various disparate systems to create a picture of what's actually going on in the environment. And then it can produce reports for me, whether it be on a dashboard. You can also create all kinds of different custom reports, you know, depending on what you want. SIEM solutions have really gotten pretty expensive and pretty confusing. You see many companies that deploy single pane of glass for event. I see a lot of people trying to. I don't see very many people doing it, right? Because SIEM solutions are actually pretty complicated and they take quite a bit of babysitting. There's a learning curve for SIEM solutions. Some of the easiest ones I think to use is probably, you know, SolarWinds is fairly comfortable out of the box, but still requires, you know, some, it has limitations. But I mean, every SIEM solution is, just takes a lot of work. So I think a lot of people buy it thinking, oh, I can get this one single pane of glass view, without realizing how much work actually goes into it, you know, how expensive they are. All right. All that good stuff. You see more outsourcing in order to have 24. Yeah, there's quite a bit of outsourcing of SIEM. Yep. Different testing methods. So static, I mentioned before, testing code passively. I mean, this code's not running. It might be, actually, it's funny. Do we have that? Do you have that? SIEM. Remember we did that market analysis for that one? That was like Gartner-ish. Do you know where that is? Is that a marketing thing? Well, we were hired to compare all of them in the market, and I think there were 34 that we found, and so it was really objective testing, but this was a few years ago. See if we can find it. Larry, make a copy if we can find it. SIEM, yep, same. Sounds Japanese. Same. I don't know. I don't speak Japanese. Yep. It's not called that anymore. Did you know that? It's called, I can't remember what it's called anymore. Security Studio. That's sweet, right? It does. Sounds important. All right, so different testing methods. I'm having a whole side conversation over here. Different testing methods. Static testing, so static, code's not running, it's just sitting there. Oftentimes that would be code review. So there's different types of code reviews. Peer code review, there's you can run it through a bunch of code review tools. But static testing, important thing to remember is the code's not running. Dynamic testing, this is on a system where the code is actually running. It's a live system. It doesn't mean it's a production live system. It just means it's a live system. It might be in a test environment. But dynamic testing is while the code is actually running. White box software testing, same thing that it kind of meant when we had white box penetration testing. We have access to the source code, data structures. We have documentation potentially in white box. Black box, we don't have any internal details. It's just treated like just another application, and we have to kind of figure all that stuff out. Traceability matrix, we would use this to map requirements to different testing strategies. So RTM, sometimes it's called too, traces the requirements and then checkbox when it's been met. And then fuzz testing, typically black box testing, just entering a bunch of random gibberish data, trying to create an exception process or a crash. And then combinatorial software testing, like it means different combinations of inputs, also another black box testing. The difference between combinatorial testing and fuzzing is combinatorial testing uses every possible input. But we'll get into that here. So again, static testing, passive code, code's not running. No execution of programs. In most cases, you'd have the source code and you would review the source code. There's a bunch of different static code analysis tools. There's tons of them. Some of them are pretty well known. So if you wanted that stuff, there's a link, a pretty good link too. Good tools. This is a traceability matrix. Static testing. Yep, this is a traceability matrix. You can see the matrix. Matrix is really just rows and columns. But on the left, you have the requirements, and then you have kind of the test cases and what the outcomes of the test cases were. That would be a traceability matrix. Pretty basic. Different types of testing. You'll want to know, you'll want to memorize this. This, a lot of organizations create a lot of software, but they don't do much of this testing. We're actually going through our first iteration internally here at FRSecure. We do some parts of this testing, but we don't, it's not a formalized testing process because we're not in production yet, really. But these are a lot of things that we're going to have to really shore up when we get, you know, out there with some of our stuff. So unit testing, low-level tests, software components, functions, procedures, and objects. Installation testing is pretty self-explanatory. Test the software as it's being installed in first run. Integration testing is how it works with other systems and other components combined into one kind of bigger working system. So it's integration, how the software integrates with other software and components. Regression testing is how things test out once you've changed it, once you've made an update to it or modification, applied a patch. Those would all be examples of regression testing. Then acceptance testing. The most common type of acceptance testing would be user acceptance testing, where the user is actually the customer, and they would sign off on the updates or whatever you've made to the software, that it meets their own operational requirements. Usually you'd use the acceptance testing going all the way back to the original specifications that the customer, you know, had told you about, so that they can map those specifications to their own operational requirements. So different types of testing, important to know and memorize. If you're not a software developer, then all this stuff may not, well, no, this isn't really software development stuff. This is kind of just stuff. Fuzzing, a lot of good fuzzing tools out there. In that sec tools, so earlier I gave you the top 125 security tools. You can just tag the fuzzers and look at some of those fuzzing ones. Again, black box testing, random malformed data. So it's meant to check boundaries. It's meant to check inputs. It's an input validation sometimes issue. A buffer overflow, which we'll talk about, and I think in two classes from now, on what that is and how that works. But essentially, in layman's terms, a buffer overflow is a certain amount of memory has been allocated to a process, and you spill over, so you basically spill over into the next memory space and potentially execute your code in layman's terms. Typically automated, because can you imagine just sending all that random data manually? So certainly automated. Burp Suite. Burp Suite is kind of a cool tool that we use quite a bit, and I think there's a fuzzing function in that. I'm not a pen tester anymore, so I don't do this type of testing, but Burp Suite is a tool that I know we use a lot. Other software testing terms, misuse case testing, which is exactly what it's meant, or what it says. Inverse of use case testing, so trying to break the rules, do things against the system to purposely cause it to looking for exploits. Test coverage analysis, that's just an analysis of your testing to determine whether you missed a specific part. So if you go back to these types of testing, most of your testing should fit within these boxes. A testing analysis would just be looking over the test plans to make sure that you covered everything. Interface testing, so this is just the interfaces that have been exposed to the, by the application. Some of them might be graphical user interface type testing. Others might, if it's a network-based application, there might be ports and services running. It might be communicating with something else, which then exposes another potential interface into the application. So interface testing is just looking at all the different interfaces that are exposed by the application and then testing all those. Then combinatorial testing, same type. It's really closely related to fuzzing. The difference here is it's not necessarily random, and it's testing all the unique combinations of software inputs. That would be combinatorial. And what did I put? What's a domain? Ad domain. I don't know what that means. All right, but that's, we've now finished domain six. We went through a whole domain in less than an hour. But I think it's all the basic stuff you need to know for the exam. And ad domain. Security operations. So tonight we're going to go through administrative security and forensics, and I'll try to pick it up a little bit. And then we'll pick up on Thursday. That was fast. That was all good. We'll pick up at incident response. Incident response is one of my favorite things too. So that'll be fun on Thursday. I don't know how much of that other stuff. Disaster recovery planning is not, to me, that's boring, but I know a lot of people really like that stuff. All right, so unique terms and definitions. So business continuity plan, continuity of operations plan, and the disaster recovery plan, and then there's a few other plans. These are actually different plans, and a lot of times people use these interchangeably. The disaster recovery plan is typically short-term, IT-focused. A business continuity plan is longer-term, really focused on continuing or keeping the business running. And a continuity of operations plan is even kind of bigger than that, is, you know, to just maintain. So these plans kind of fit together. I think it's NIST SP 800-62 maybe, that has a really good outline of what these plans are, but we'll get to that. Collusion is when one or more, you know, two or more people operate together to break the rules, subvert the security of a system, commit fraud, something like that. A disaster is a disruptive event. Now, disasters are like security, like the word secure is a relative term. So in every organization, there might be a slightly different definition of what constitutes a disaster. The important thing is that you need to define what constitutes a disaster. At this level, it's just a disruptive event. But, you know, in practice, you'd put more to it than that. Other terms that we're not going to get to tonight, but we will get to on Thursday, would be mean time between failures. So how long can I expect this thing to run before it's going to fail on average? People who make things typically subject those things to testing to see how long this thing runs before we can expect it to fail. And they oftentimes will publish that. So you can take that into account, you know, in your own environment. I'm sorry. This is security operations domain. I didn't even say that. This is security operations. So security operations is kind of the day-to-day maintenance and management of security. So it's taking kind of that more high-level strategic stuff and kind of putting it more into a procedural type place. It's kind of weird that business continuity and disaster recovery are kind of in this domain, but they are. Mirroring. So mirroring, creating duplication across two disks or more. Redundant array of inexpensive disks. We'll talk about the RAID arrays and things like that and striping, but not tonight. That's Thursday. So administrative security. Administrative security, whenever I think of it, anything administrative, the first thing I think of is people. So administrative security, control people's operational access to data. So it has to do with the people part of security. Concepts that we've talked about before, but here they are again. Concept of least privilege and minimum necessary access. Oftentimes these are referred to in more discretionary access control systems. you give people the least amount of access and privilege that they need in order to get their job done, and that's it. That's the concept. And more of a mandatory access control system is the need to know. So beyond just having, we had subjects and objects. Subjects have clearance, objects have labels. So that's one way to control access, but then the next piece is having the need to know. So just because I have clearance, I might have top secret clearance. If I don't have a need to know, then I shouldn't have access to that. So this really rides on top of having the clearance and labels that we've talked about before. An extension to the principle of least privilege is mandatory access control. Environments is the concept of compartmentalization, which we've also talked about before. So that integrates the need to know on top of labels and clearances. So these are things that we can implement as administrative controls. Most of these are preventative, sometimes, I guess, separation of duties, preventative. So as an example, the same person who, I always have trouble with like accounts payable, in accounts payable, the same person who approves payments shouldn't be the same person who can cut checks and be the same person who can sign checks. And you know what I'm saying? You need to break that chain up so that multiple people are necessary in order to complete that transaction. So when we look at an organization for separation of duties issues, here's another place like access control. So me being able to request access to something and also be able to approve it and also be able to give myself access, that's kind of a problem. But you see that a lot in where IT serves as the data owner and the data custodian and maybe the data user. So separating, looking for opportunities where we can separate out as a compensating control or a mitigating control where I can't implement. Because one of the things with separation of duties is it requires usually more staff because I need to have somebody else be able to do a part of this. And I may not be able to justify that expense. A mitigating control on the detection side of things is I could implement stronger logging and auditing functions around these areas where I lack segregation of duties or separation of duties as another thing. So the goal is to break it up. Collusion is when two or more, when we try to break it up by separation of duties and then those people start conspiring. Usually it's over, what, coffee, beer? What do people do this? Is it coffee? Do people colluding around coffee? Yeah, I figured that's what I'd do too. But they get together, they conspire, and they violate collusion. Another administrative control that we could put in place is rotation of duties, job rotation. The purpose here is two, really, I think, big purposes. One is we've got some backup staff. So if somebody did leave the organization, we have another person who could maybe fill in. That's one thing. Another thing is if, let's say I'm working in this highly sensitive role, but I know that I'm going to be rotating out and Rob is going to be rotating into my role. You know, we kind of have this rotation. Well, then I might be less prone to do fraudulent things knowing that Rob is going to be sitting in my seat next week. So there's some deterrent there. It's also a good detective control because Rob might actually find something that I was doing that I shouldn't be doing. So job rotation or rotation of responsibilities, that's really what it's sort of meant for. And a lot of people say the hit by the bus scenario. I'm more of a positive guy, so I say win the lottery. You know, that's the positive way of saying it. Exam warning, so rotation of duties is another one of those things. So kind of in the absence of being able to rotate duties, things like that, maybe implement better logging and monitoring is a mitigating control. Mandatory leave, forced vacation. The purpose here, again, is we'll definitely identify areas where we're lacking coverage because if Rob goes on vacation for 2 weeks and nothing gets done for 2 weeks, well, then we got a problem. We have to figure out some way to supplement Rob's job. So no vacations for you, right? Unless we go for a bike ride, we can do that. Also known as forced vacation, identifiers where depth of coverage is lacking, discover fraudulent, suspicious behavior, because, you know, one of the things, if I was going to commit fraud, because one thing I've noticed about crooks and criminals is they're kind of a paranoid bunch. So they might be less prone to committing crimes or doing bad things if they know that they're going to be forced on vacation for a couple weeks, because I'm going to be wondering what the heck are they doing while I'm on vacation. But plus it gives an opportunity to do some investigative work. You have some legal issues usually with this, because it needs to be part of kind of your standard business processes if you're going to conduct an investigation of somebody while they're on vacation. But it's another administrative control. Non-disclosure agreements, usually, I think, I don't know, the purpose of a non-disclosure agreement is to get people to sign and commit that all the things that they're doing or whatever's in this agreement is meant to be confidential and not disclosed to anybody who doesn't have authorization. Excuse me, blah, blah, blah. Usually, you know, upon hire, there's a lot of, you know, you'd really want to get legal involved in non-disclosure agreements and confidentiality agreements, because in different jurisdictions are a lot, there's a big difference, I think, in enforceability. Largely a directive control, but that's another potential administrative control. Background checks, I think background checks are pretty cool. Background checks work as sometimes a good deterrent and detective control and a preventative control. They deter if bad people or people that, you know, have criminal histories want to come and work for you and they know that you do background checks, that might keep them out the door. Or it might allow, if they know you're going to be doing a background check and you say, hey, you know, part of our process is you get to kind of come clean, and we might, you know, usually there's questions about disclosing whatever. They might be more prone to disclose it rather than you find out about it later. Plus, you know, you might actually find other stuff. So background checks are a good idea. I haven't done an assessment of a bank in quite a while, but even up to a couple of years ago, it seems like a lot of banks, small banks, were still not doing background checks, which I thought was just really interesting. So background checks, also known as background investigations, pre-employment screening. The majority of background investigations are performed as part of the pre-employment screening process. It's always a good idea to complete this prior to their first day or prior to even offering them a position. Sensitivity of the position should be taken into account. Some positions within the organization are more sensitive. Some work with money, some don't work with money. Some work with sensitive data, some don't. So taking those into account, this is more of a maturity process. So as your background check process matures over time, getting more granular in the type of background checks or checks that you do on different types of employees is probably a good idea. Ongoing post-employment, this is fairly rare, but it's also a good thing because really when you think about it, we did a background check on Rob, and Rob's fallen on hard times, haven't you, Rob? Starting to do things he shouldn't have been doing, committed a few crimes here and there, but we're not doing ongoing post-employment background checks, so we have no idea you're doing any of this stuff. Shame on us. Crimes everywhere. I was just kidding. That was hypothetical. Right. So, but that's one of the things that we don't see very often is people don't do continuous background checks. There's an expense involved, but certainly it's a good idea. A little bit about background checks. Privilege monitoring, those people that have elevated privileges. This is beyond just normal user accounts. So if you're doing like a role-based access control, you have certain roles within your organization that have additional rights and privileges than other kind of standard roles. Those heightened privileges should require an additional amount of scrutiny, should have maybe an additional level of monitoring. So certainly in the prevention piece, you kind of, they already have access. So prevention is, you're limited somewhat, but, you know, certainly the detection piece, great. Some of the job functions that require greater scrutiny, account creation, modification, deletion, system reboots, obviously all your IT administrator type functions, and application administrator type functions should receive an additional level of scrutiny. And now with the advent of ransomware, that was a big topic last week. You know, the extent of your privileges and rights leads to potentially more access, which then wreaks more havoc potentially. So increased monitoring. Any good solutions to perform ongoing monitoring for administrative accounts? Off the top of my head, I can't think of any. Are you seeing that same? Do you see the same? You don't see the chat, do you? Did you see the chat? Can we pose that to the analysts maybe tomorrow? So I can't think of any on the top of my head. That's one of the not good things about being product agnostic is we don't represent products. So, but I know we've run into them, a bunch of different ones. Yes, manage engine, almost all the manage engine tools. Good one, Wes. Almost all the manage engine tools I've heard good things about. Oh, Varonis. Yeah, Varonis is expensive as all get out, but yeah, it's a great tool too. No, I think we're good. These are good ones for him to check out. All right, let's move on. Digital forensics. Ooh, sounds kind of high tech. All right, so digital forensics. So forensics is, you've decided really where we usually insert forensics into the incident response process. So this is very tightly integrated in most cases with the incident response process. So there's a certain point in an incident response, and it kind of varies from place to place slightly, where you decide on whether or not we want to conduct forensics or not. And usually what indicates that we're going to do a full forensics investigation is going to be whether this is going to be a legal issue or maybe an HR issue, where we need to have some solid justification for what we're doing. So at the end of the day, you decide it's going to be a forensic investigation. To the quality of evidence is going to be paramount. So when you go into a court of law, the first things that an opposing counsel will attack, it will be, one, your credibility, two, the quality of your evidence, and three, which is closely related to the quality of the evidence, will be who had access to the evidence. So forensics is very evidence specific. We would gather this evidence to prove some type of a point. Maybe we would also use this for a root cause analysis. But you can think of it the same way as you think of a physical crime scene where, you know, there's a body and whatever, you know, like the OJ trial. I always think of that for like forensics. Why is that? That's weird. But you need to preserve the evidence so that you can present that evidence to somebody else to make a case. So really preserving that evidence becomes paramount. And we have a rule of thumb that if you can't, if you're going too fast to be able to document every single thing that you've done, then you're going too fast. So I think that's the number one rookie mistake that I've seen in forensic investigations is just this rush to get the investigation done because you're excited about what you might find. So slow and steady. So preventing unintentional modification of the system, anti-forensics makes forensics investigation difficult or impossible. So anti-forensics are techniques that attackers might use to try to hide evidence that they've ever been there or that anything happened on the system. A simple anti-forensics technique would be to delete log files. More sophisticated ones might be non-persistent applications that only run in memory. And as soon as you remove power, you remove all evidence that I was there. So anti-forensics is kind of that the techniques that attackers would use to not allow a good forensics investigation. Viable data gathered during live forensic capture. We'll talk about live forensic capture in just a little bit, and we're wrapping up, so we're getting close to being done. Main sources of forensic data, binary images. Now, that's important. It's got to be a binary image. That's an exact copy. It's ones and zeros. It's not a right-click copy and you know, click over here and right-click paste. It's a binary copy. It's you know, block by block. It's bit by bit. So binary images of secondary storage portable devices, hard drives, USB flash drives, CDs, DVDs, whatever it is that's a source for the forensic. Important piece to remember that is that binary images, bitstream image is another way that they might refer to it. Exact replica, yeah. Normal backup software usually won't suffice. So we do have some tools that we use. There's a ton of actually free tools nowadays that people use. But FTK is a pretty popular one. NCASE is still the market leader. We'll talk about those too. So four types of data that exist. Allocated space. So this is data that the operating system has marked as actively containing data. And we're not going to go really deep into digital forensics because you could really spend a whole 13-week or more class just talking about forensics and how you would preserve the data, write blockers and drive duplicators and a bunch of other stuff. But we're just going to keep it kind of at this level. So one of the places where you might find data is allocated space, that space that's been marked by the operating system as having actual data in it. Attackers can also hide data or put data into unallocated space. So this would be something that isn't marked as having active data. You could delete a file and it's still in unallocated space. Slack space, this is data that kind of spills over from one cluster. So clusters are have a minimum file size, and if something breaks over that minimum file size, so say the minimum file size is 8 bytes and I have a 12 byte file, well, I have 8 bytes written to this cluster, 4 bytes written to this cluster, and I've got 4 bytes left over. That's the Slack space. And so you can, you know, certainly hide data in Slack space. And then bad blocks, clusters, or sectors. These are things that have been marked as being bad. The attacker himself or herself might have actually marked it that way and then hidden data in it. So the operating system itself would never access those clusters or blocks or sectors because they're marked as being bad, but actually they're not. So those are kind of the four types or places where we would potentially put data. Numerous tools, like I said, there are tons of tools for binary backup, and a lot of them are free. I guess if you're going to do a forensic investigation yourself, the quality of your tool would probably also be called into question. So be careful about, you know, the free tools that you use. If it's generally used, meaning it's not just something you wrote yourself, then there's a better chance that it might be accepted or less challenged. But Access Data, FTK, and NCASE, those are both two tools that have been used in thousands of legal cases throughout the year. So those are pretty good tools. The general phases of forensic process, identification of potential evidence. So where might we find the things that we're looking for, or, you know, that might give us a conclusion or a conclusion of, you know, what happened. Then the next phase is acquisition of the evidence. So some of that evidence might be physical, some of that evidence might be technical or logical. So even to the case, I've been in investigations before where we needed to go to a remote location and actually seize or take a desktop or a laptop. And we would go out there with a chain of custody. And when we acquired the evidence, we would take pictures of the environment so that we could say this is where we took it from and all that stuff. So acquisition of the evidence, I mean, you've kind of already started the forensic investigation really in earnest when you've gotten to this acquisition place. It's time to start documenting heavily. Then analysis of the evidence and then production of the report. Those are the four general phases. Hashing algorithms, so we mentioned MD5 is a very popular hashing algorithm to just validate the integrity of a file or a binary image. So, you know, write blocking the file, a drive or the media, creating a binary image, and then using a hashing algorithm to calculate a hash so that you can then determine if anything changed on that binary image. Original media should not be used for analysis. So maintain the original and use the copy. If you remember the federal rules of civil procedure, 8.11, 8.12, I can't remember exactly which one, but I already passed the test, so you guys have to remember that, allows us to use copies. Live forensics. So it used to be the first thing you would do, so a bad thing happens, first thing you do is go run over and unplug the computer. That's, you know, that's not the way to do it anymore, even if it ever was, I guess, maybe. So live forensics is capturing evidence on a live system before you shut it down. Because there are a number of things that are happening in a system. So another example, so I'm going to go through just this example. It's from the book about Metasploit and Meterpreter. But just think about network connections. You know, walking up to a computer and opening up a command prompt and typing in netstat, I will see the network, the active network connections on that system, which might be really valuable to me as an investigator, whereas if I just come and run and shut the system down, I lost all those persistent or those non-persistent network connections, and I will never know potentially who was connected at that time if it's not saved appropriately. You know what I'm saying? So live forensics is important, certainly for the volatile data that won't stay there. So one example is Meterpreter, which, because Meterpreter runs almost entirely in memory, so nothing is really written to disk. So live forensics becomes, you know, really important. So Metasploit, never used Metasploit. Used to be a lot more popular than I think it is now. There's a bunch of other tools and frameworks that people use more often now. Popular free open source exploitation framework. Like I mentioned before, there's a paid version supported by Rapid7 too. The framework allows you to create modules and different types of tests and exploits and things within the framework. So it's a nice kind of playground to create things. Reusable components, limited extra work. All that good stuff happens with Metasploit. So Meterpreter, very powerful. Metasploit payload certainly allows you to do a bunch of different things. It's always updated. At least it was. I don't do pen testing much anymore. So I haven't used Meterpreter in probably 3-4 years. It can allow password hashes, compromised computer to be dumped to an attacker's machine. And this is all from memory, so nothing is actually being written to the target computer. Password hashes can then be fed into the password cracker. And then there's a little more information there on some of the tools like PSExec. PSExec is owned by Microsoft now. It used to be CISSP internals. And then pass the hash functionality. I don't know if you guys know what pass the hash is, but it's being able to authenticate, in simple terms, it's being able to authenticate with a service by passing the hash as opposed to passing the password, which would then have to be hashed and then authenticated against the database. So passing the hash is just trying to authenticate with the hash value as opposed to the password that gets hashed. So that's what that is. But anyway, Meterpreter, a little bit more about Meterpreter and all the cool things you can do with it, dumping password hashes, also command execution of the remote system, uploading, downloading files, screen capture, keystroke logging, disabling the firewall, disabling AV, registry viewing and modification, again, all within, all running from memory. And here's just, this is an example of a hash dump. So this is dumping password hashes with Meterpreter. Dumping the registry with Meterpreter, certainly designed to evade detection. No files, all within an exploited process. Dumping the registry, this is just an example of what that looks like, or looked like. I should just get out some tools again if I had time. All right, so if the forensic investigator removed the power from the system, you'd destroy memory and you'd potentially lose, well, you would lose valuable evidence of what took place. Let's see, that's it. 5 minutes to go. So we got through a lot of stuff today. We finished up identity and access management. We did all of security testing, assessment testing. We got through, I think, some good stuff on the security operations. Homework for Thursday, which is now June. It's crazy. Leadership Domain 7. I'll get the access control quiz to you as soon as we're done. And that's it. So thank you guys. Hope you enjoyed it. We will see you all on Thursday.